So our next speaker is Liz Gillis. Liz is from Dublin. She is one of the leading experts on the role of women in the Irish Revolution. She wrote a book, 77 Women, about the women who were interned for taking part in the Easter Rising. And she also has a book on revolution, women in the revolution, a large photographic volume, and also has written biographies of the Hales brothers in Cork, and has written the Mercer Press Military History of the Civil War, the initial battle in Dublin City. So I'll ask you please to put your hands together and give a very warm welcome to Liz Gillis.
Thanks a million, Pádraig, and it's absolutely wonderful to be here with such a fantastic audience. Thank you all so much for turning out, and thanks, Pádraig, for the invitation to speak here. So I'm going to talk about women and the Civil War, because the Civil War, it is always called a war of brothers, but no one was left unaffected by the Civil War, and women had as much a role to play in the Civil War as combatants, as participants, as witnesses, as the men did. So I'm going to start and go back a little bit to the treaty debates, because at the time that the Anglo-Irish Treaty was signed, six women had been elected to the Dáil, and we've got the six women right here. And they are Kathleen Clark, the widow of Tom Clark, executed in 1916, Countess Markovich, Kate O'Callaghan, Mrs. Pearce, the mother of Patrick and William Pearce, Dr. Ada English, and Mary McSweeney. And these women, on their own merits, had been elected. You have Mrs. Pearce, I suppose, when it comes to the treaty debates, that she does actually speak for her dead sons. But the other women really have every right to speak their views on why they rejected the treaty, because all of these women rejected the treaty. And the Dáil debates are absolutely fascinating. They're all available online to read for free. If you want a bit of homework, go home, look at them. They are just amazing, because you can literally see the breakdown of the friendships. You're reading it in front of your eyes. But the speeches are powerful, both from the men and the women. And to talk to you a little bit about Kate O'Callaghan, because she has the Limerick connection. She was born Murphy. She's born in County Cork, and she was a lecturer at Mary Immaculate College in Limerick. She was a founding member and later president of the Limerick branch of Cumann na mBan. And in 1920, she married Michael O'Callaghan, who was the Lord Mayor of Limerick, who unfortunately was killed, shot and killed by the Crown Forces in March 1921, in front of her, something similar to what happened to Tomás McCourtain in front of his wife a year earlier in March 1920. And she's elected to the Dáil in May 1921 for Limerick City and Limerick East. And when we look at the Dáil debates, and I'm sure you've heard the speeches, or some of the speeches, or some of the phrases that were used, in that the women were accused of being emotional, the women were accused of being irrational, they are rattling the bones of the dead. And I want to just read out this excerpt from a speech. And this was in the debates that happened between December and January 21 and 22. And it says, "Do not mistake that we cannot get away from the principle that we are here in this Dáil standing for the Irish Republic and the Irish Republic only. We cannot have different shades of that Republic. We have, for instance, reference to the uncompromising, opportunistic shade. I do not conform to that. I may be a diehard, but it is better diehard than soft. Terence McSweeney died hard. He was over 90 days dying. What did he die for? Did he die for this thing that is before us? Is there any of the men who have engraved their names on the list of martyrology of the men of 1916, of those who fell on the scaffold or before the firing party, who would have signed that? Are there any of the men who fought and fell in battle who would have done so?" Very emotional, a very highly emotional speech that was made by this man, Sean Etchingham. So everyone made emotional speeches during the Dáil debates. It was not just the women. But to bring it back to Kate O'Callaghan, and as I said at the start, the women, they had their own reasons for choosing the way they chose to go, and whether they would reject, on the fact that they would reject the treaty. It was not down only to the fact that their relatives had died. Mrs. Pearce, she does state that in her statement that she makes or a speech that she makes. But everyone else, every other woman, they actually have their own points of view and reasons. And just to read out a bit of what Kate O'Callaghan says, she says there, "I want to be understood here and now that I have the clearest right in the world to make the decision that I've made. I paid a big price for that treaty and for my right to stand here." The last deputy talked about indecent rattling off the bones of the dead in this assembly. "Since I came up to Dublin for this session, I have been told, with a view to changing my vote, I suppose, that my husband was never a Republican. I challenge any deputy in this dial to deny my husband's devotion to the Republic." Now, she continues, "There's a third point I want to clear up. When it was found that the women deputies of Andal were not open to canvass, the matter was dismissed with the remark, 'Oh, naturally, these women are very bitter.' Well, now I protest against that. No woman in the stall is going to give her vote merely because she is warped by a deep personal loss. The women of Ireland so far have not appeared much on the political stage. That does not mean that they have no deep convictions about Ireland's status and freedom. It was the mother of the Pearces who made them what they were. The sister of Terence McSweeney influenced her brother and is now carrying on his life's work." So, not just these women are representative of Cumann na mBan as a whole. Cumann na mBan did not follow blindly into whether they as an organisation should vote on whether to accept or reject the treaty. Cumann na mBan held their convention on the 5th of February 1922. The IRA held their convention in March 1922. Now you have close to 600 delegates. Not every branch was represented. There was a rail strike going on. A lot of people couldn't attend. But roughly 600 delegates representing the branches of Cumann na mBan did attend the convention held in the Mansion House. And you can see here the results. 419 voted to reject the treaty compared to 63. So overwhelmingly, they reject that treaty. And they are not doing that just because their husbands or their brothers or their sweethearts have made that decision. They are making that in their own right. The anti-treaty side, they kept the name Cumann na mBan. Now you do have a bit of to-ing and fro-ing between the Cork branch. There's a big split there between Mary McSweeney and the Conlon sisters, where both sides, the Conlon sisters went pro-treaty, Mary McSweeney goes anti-treaty, and they actually play out their arguments in public. It happens in the newspapers, and it gets really nasty and bitter, and both sides want to retain the name Cumann na mBan. The anti-treaty side went out because the pro-treaty side, they do become known as Cumann na Saoirse, or as the war goes on, Cumann na Searchers, a derogatory term that was used by the anti-treaty women. Now, just to show you the two groups, just on the left-hand side, we have Cumann na mBan marching in the funeral procession of Cathal Brua. And unfortunately, that scene was going to be repeated many, many times over the coming year and beyond, right up until October 1924, when the bodies of the executed anti-treaty IRA men were handed back to their families. Here we have just a group of Cumann na Saoirse, the pro-treaty group down in in County Cork. There's a fantastic book, 10... or Extraordinary Women. It was written by the Shandon Women's History Group. It's a fantastic book on the women of Cork City, and you do get the divide there, both pro and anti-treaty women. But you can see there, two groups very active in their support of both the National Army and the anti-treaty IRA. And I suppose the title of the talk, Sister Against Sister, well, here's just one of the many families that was affected by the Civil War, where you do have sisters on opposite sides. And there were the Ryans from Tom Cool in County Wexford, a big, big Republican family, as in the sisters had been out with their brother Jim in 1916, active in the War of Independence and certainly in the Civil War. But just to go along, we have in the back row Jim Ryan, who later became the Fianna Fáil TD, Dr. Jim Ryan. He married Maureen Cregan. Both of them are on the anti-treaty side. As we go along, we have Kit. Two of them down, we have Nell, who goes anti-treaty, and then Min Ryan, who married Richard Mulcahy during the War of Independence, just at the end of the back row, she goes pro-treaty. And then we have in the front row, you have Agnes, who went pro-treaty. She was married to Dennis McCullough, who was pro-treaty. And then we have Phyllis, the youngest sister, who was anti-treaty. So here you have a family that is literally split down the middle. And I was very lucky to have met Min's daughter, Elizabeth Birney, and talked to her about how the sisters were impacted by the Civil War. You have Min and you have Agnes both being married to two men who support the treaty. And the sisters are urging them to leave their husbands. Well, what could those women do? They had young families in the case of Min. How could they leave their husbands? So you literally have a family that are divided. Thankfully, they were able to survive the divisions of the Civil War. They were able to put aside politics, resulting in the fact that their children were able to grow up knowing each other. But as I said, there is a family, predominantly women, sisters, that are split right down the middle in this conflict. So what did the women do? Well, we know from 1916 and the War of Independence what the women were capable of doing. Propaganda, first aid, dispatch carrying, intelligence. They continued that work. Propaganda, the women are experts. The pro-treaty government, the National Army, they know how valuable and important the women are when it comes to propaganda. But you do also have women being combatants in the Civil War, and I'll mention one or two. But here we have Tilly Simpson, who had been a veteran in 1916. She was a very active member of the Fairview branch of Cumann na mBan, and she served in one of the many anti-treaty IRA outposts in Dublin when the Civil War began. So while you have women serving in the forecourt and then later the block, which is all that series of buildings in O'Connell Street, the anti-treaty IRA were in occupation of Barry's Hotel, but also Moran's and Hughes Hotel at Talbot Street. You have them in Parnell Square, they're in Jenkinson's, and in nearly every one of these buildings you will find women. You have Mary Harper, who was anti-treaty and later goes on to marry a lad who had served in, or was a member of the Free State Army. They'd been childhood friends. But she was in Jenkins's in Capel Street. And you have at one point where her future husband is ordering his soldiers to aim and fire at her because she was crossing a barricade, and then she later marries him. But you have the women very, very active in this period. Tilly, she served in Moran's Hotel and the Gresham Hotel. She was treating the wounded, and she is one of over 500 women that ends up being imprisoned, arrested and imprisoned during the Civil War. Now, whereas you had 77 women arrested after 1916, you have a handful of women being imprisoned in the War of Independence. Mainly they're held in Mountjoy. You have, firstly, the women being arrested, taken to Mountjoy Jail. As the Civil War goes on, you have the net going wider. And the emergency legislation that was brought in by the provisional government, where they could arrest people, carry out raids and so on, women weren't really being arrested at that time. They amend the legislation in early 1923, where if they think you're going to do something, then that's liable for you to be arrested. So you see then the massive swoops that happen in February and March 1923, and you see the massive roundups of the women all across the country, and they're brought then to Cumann Jail, to Mountjoy Jail, and also the North Dublin Union. That's where they're held all together. It was believed it would be easier to keep them in one place, but the women didn't, or they proved to be a little bit troublesome when they were together in the one place. But just to show you this image, we do have a lot of autograph books. We are very, very lucky that a lot of prisoners, both men and women, kept autograph books while they were in prison. So here we have an entry from Tilly Simpson. And you can see it there, Goose Green, Drumcondra, Cumann in February 1923. So that's one of the first sort of sweeps that happens with the arrests of the women, and then more follow, as I say, in March. Held in Cumann, and then she's held in the North Dublin Union. So these are a hugely important resource. And John mentioned the pension files. They're another huge, huge, huge resource in telling us the story of what it was like for the ordinary rank and file volunteers of Cumann na mBan at this time. Huge thanks to Laz Fallon for telling me about this pension file, which was left by or made by Marie MacDonald, who served in the block. So she's in O'Connell Street at the start of the Civil War, and she served with her future husband, Austin MacDonald, who had been a fireman, and he's in the block as well. Now, she is being told you have to go to the YMCA building, you have to go to this building. She's literally going everywhere in O'Connell Street. And all she is worried about is that she wants to see her sweetheart, Austin. If all of this goes up, she wants to die with him. And just to read out a little bit of what she writes, she's talking about herself and Anna Schwepp. They were told to go to bed at 12 o'clock. Anna went, but I refused. I was expecting Austin. We got in a lot of free state prisoners late in the night, and also some of the medical staff, which evacuated Moran's Hotel and Barry, so the likes of Tilly Simpson, when that position is, it falls, they retreat back to the block. The nurses told me they had to crawl out of Moran's Hotel. Such fearless souls as I saw all around me, with pale drawn faces, but all with a laugh and a song. At last came Austin. I ran to him and we whispered in the hall through the din of noise and shooting. We had just got word that we would be shelled and to be ready with all our clothes and for any eventuality. So we said goodbye and we're glad that we would meet the same death together. Now, the block, although it did capitulate, they didn't die in battle. They went on to marry and have a long life together. But sadly, and I mentioned that at the start, we do have these scenes being replicated over and over and over again, and they are the funerals. And one of the first funerals that the women are involved in is the funeral of Cathal Brua, who died on the 7th of July, the funeral's on the 10th of July. But as the Civil War goes on, the men are on the run. Someone has to bury the fallen, so it falls to the women. They were also doing, while they're doing the Guard of Honour, as they are here, in the Mater Hospital with Cathal Brua, they're in the funeral procession, and they're the ones that are actually members of the firing party. And this continues right throughout the Civil War. The Cooney sisters, three sisters from my neck of the woods, from the Liberties Basin Lane, and their pension file is so, so detailed, but they were involved in everything. And when the fighting breaks out, they're involved, are told to go to South Darrell Street, the dispensary there, but they're bringing dispatches, they're bringing intelligence, they're actually gathering up weaponry from a position that has been abandoned by the anti-treaty IRA, but also, somehow, they were involved in the planned escape from Mountjoy Jail that happened in October 1922. Now, this was the failed escape where Paddy Breslin, a prisoner, gets killed. But they were told to smuggle in guns and a uniform. And somehow they did it. I do not know how they did it, because all Annie says in her pension file is that I received instructions from inside Mountjoy Prison to send in revolvers and ammunition, also an National Army officer's uniform, and they did. I don't know how they did, but they did. They made numerous journeys to Mountjoy and smuggled in the guns and ammunition and also the uniform. The escape did go ahead, but it did fail and Paddy Breslin was killed. And I mentioned propaganda. Now, the thing was, unfortunately, like with the men, with the Civil War, all of the safe places, the safe houses, they were known to the National Army because they had used them themselves in the War of Independence. They knew how good the women were at propaganda because they had been their friends and had used it to such good effect after 1916 and the War of Independence, and now they were a huge threat. And just to give you two examples, two artists here, we have Grace Gifford and we have Countess Markovitch. And Grace Gifford, the widow of Joseph Plunkett, who was an artist, that was her livelihood. But you can see the women did not hold back in their artwork, in their depictions of what they felt had to be said, in their use of propaganda. Grace Gifford's poster just on the left, and you can see it there, it's National Army soldiers surrounding Dublin Castle, and what is the tagline? Was for this they died. This one on the right, that was drawn by Countess Markovitch, another fantastic artist, and you can actually see a lot of her work, the examples of her propaganda work, Civil War in Kilmainham Jail. And this is for an anti-treaty Republican news sheet. There were many newspapers issued by the Ann Street IRA at that time, and this is depicting the murder of Sean Cole and Alfred Colley, two members of Na Fianna, who were taken out from the north side of Dublin City, and their bodies were then found dumped in Yellow Lane out in Drumcondra. This was 4 days after Michael Collins had died. They're the first of the reprisal killings that unfortunately happened. But there you have the truth being told by Countess Markovich through propaganda, and these would have been posted up all over Dublin City. Very, very powerful. So another reason why the women had to be taken off the streets. Breed O'Milan, a very, very active member of Cumann na mBan, joined after 1917, great organiser for Cumann na mBan, so good the Antrim or the actual IRA, the War of Independence, thought she was a spy, they were going to kill her, luckily enough they didn't. But she takes the Antrim Treaty side, and she was the director of propaganda, so she would have been overseeing the distribution of the material like what I've just shown you there. And she's arrested. A number of women are arrested in the latter part of 1922. She's arrested in November and imprisoned in Mountjoy Jail. And then she's actually in Mountjoy when the four men are executed, Rory O'Connor, Liam Mellows, Dick Barrett and Joe McKelvey. And while we have heard of how that affected the men, the women were just as deeply affected by those executions. They were there, they were witness to those executions. They heard the gunshots just like the men did. But she was transferred to Cumann in 1923, and she's appointed OC of the prisoners in A Wing. You have Margaret Buckley, she's appointed the OC of the prisoners in B Wing, which is the older part of Cumann. A Wing is the east part, the east wing, the newer part. And you have the hunger strikes taken place through, for or during the Civil War and after the Civil War ends. And just like the men, the women do take part in the hunger strikes, and we have Breed O'Milan organising the hunger strike in Cumann, and it's in protest at the way the women were being treated at that time. Now, you do have the women being transferred to the North Dublin Union. Now, Cumann was bad at that time. The North Dublin Union was an awful place, and the women were being transferred at a time when Mary McSweeney was on hunger strike in Cumann, and they feared that Mary McSweeney would be allowed to die, because the Free State government were not willing to back down. The women refused to leave Cumann, and there's fantastic descriptions of this, where the Free State soldiers are coming up the metal staircase, that big metal staircase in the East Wing, and there's a group of women basically waiting on the top floor. And someone shouted, "No surrender," and then all hell broke loose. And it took the Free State soldiers over 4 hours to remove about 60 women. They were kicked, beaten, dragged down those stairs. One of them was 15 years old. You had girls as young as 14 to 18 years old being arrested and imprisoned as political prisoners in Cumann jail. At that time, one of them was a girl called Kay Folan from Galway. They eventually do transfer the women over to the North Dublin Union. Mary McSweeney does not die on hunger strike. And here we have Sheila Humphreys. And Sheila Humphreys was a prisoner in Mountjoy. She's a prisoner in Cumann jail. And when I mentioned combatants, Sheila Humphreys is one of the combatants. She's arrested when the National Army come raiding her house because she was the niece of the O'Rahilly, very, very Republican family. And Ernie O'Malley was hiding in the house, was a secret compartment in the house. A gunfight broke out. Sheila Humphreys is actually involved in the gunfight. Her aunt is wounded. They're all arrested. Ernie O'Malley is shot a number of times, and she and her aunt are arrested. Now, she was one of the longest serving women prisoners in the Civil War. She's held for roughly a year. She's held long after the Civil War is over. She's released in November 1923. But Sheila is involved in an escape attempt. And again, the escape stories are dominated by the men, but the women themselves, they did try to tunnel out of Cumann. And I've seen the tunnel, the remnants of it are still there. It was discovered because the warder, or the matron, she found Sheila's shoes. And Margaret Buckley, she wrote about this in her book, The Jangle of the Keys, which has been recently republished. It's a brilliant account. But it was under the kitchen And they got out. They got like a fair distance away, but thanks to Sheila leaving her shoes there, the tunnel was discovered. And when Margaret Buckley tells the girls, "You have been found out, the tunnel is no more," really, they weren't too bothered. One of them laughed and they just went, "Ah, sure, we'll try again." But there we have a young woman who dedicated her life to the freedom of Ireland. Now, this woman, I know nothing about her. I was just trawling through the autograph book, so if anyone knows anything about Margaret Morrissey from Limerick, either please tell Porrick or please tell me. I'd love to know more about her, because this is all I know, is that she is from, where is it? Do you know where Lyke Kelly is? Does anyone know her? Has anyone heard of her? Okay, so we can find out more about Margaret Morrissey, because all I have is in an autograph book. So I would love to know, because at the moment there's no pension file on her, there's nothing on her. So if we can find out more about this woman, that would be great. I know she was held in Kilmainham jail. That's it. But it does show you that there are still so many more stories that we have to discover. And I'm just going to say a huge thank you to Porrick for this one. John already mentioned this lady, Mary Hartney, because tragically we did, or there were four members of Cumann na mBan, or four women that were killed or died during the Civil War, and one of them, one of the first ones, was Mary Hartney, who died when the shell hit the hotel in Adair. I hope what this talk has shown is that the Civil War, although called a war of brothers, gender didn't matter. Sisters fought against each other, husbands and wives. Everyone was affected by this conflict. But the women made a stand just as the men did. And the women had every right to make a stand just as the men did. And they made their choices not because their husbands or their brothers or their fathers did so. They made those choices, whether it be pro-treaty or anti-treaty, because they had the convictions, they had the courage of their convictions. They had fought and sacrificed as much as the men for the Republic. Four women died in the Civil War. Tragically, so many more women were to suffer ill health and die quite young as a result of the treatment they had endured during the Civil War. And they, just like the men, paid a very, very high price for the freedom of their country. Thank you.